Thank you for those who've come to hear the session. It's unusual to be able to reflect on 20 years of work that's been done, and it's really been done by everybody who's sitting on this panel. And a special thanks to Wayne Passmore and Diana Hancock for organizing this session, because in the wake of the financial crisis, it's kind of interesting to think about what we learned 20 years ago, what's the same and what's different. And so it's really a nice opportunity to reflect on some of those things that we did learn and realize that some of the things that were very controversial 20 years ago had a fairly large impact on how policy developed. So I've had 20 years of co-authorship with Joe Peek, and our tradition has always been that I would do half and he would do half, so we're going to keep with that tradition. I've been very fortunate over the last 20 years to have a co-author who's been willing to work together in so many different ways, and it's really nice to be able to reflect on basically 20 years of work with Joe. And this work started with Joe, and then we did a number of articles after that, so it's really been nice to have that opportunity to think about some of these issues again. 20 years ago, the credit crunch was actually a fairly controversial issue. It was in the 1990s. It primarily affected New England initially. So I got involved on credit crunch issues because Dick Zirin was giving a lot of testimony at that time, given what was happening in New England. We lost a good number of our banks during that financial or during that banking crisis, and we started looking at how it was having a broader impact on the real economy. The credit crunch started to move down to the mid-Atlantic states. Eventually, the West Coast also had a problem. But it was a very different kind of problem than what we've been facing in 2007 and 2008. The mechanism was actually fairly straightforward. Because banks have deposit insurance, it really wasn't a liquidity problem. It was really a capital problem. And so banks that took losses on real estate values had gone down. Loan losses increased. Banks lost a lot of capital. When the banks were capital constrained, they reacted by shrinking their balance sheets, and they shrank their balance sheets primarily by shrinking lending. So the mechanism was actually fairly straightforward. The conclusion that it might have a real effect on the economy actually was not as straightforward. So the Board of Governors, at least initially, had a very different view than particularly the Boston Fed at that time. And so there was a lot of interaction. After 2 or 3 years, Chairman Greenspan was talking about headwinds in monetary policy, and he had obviously bought on to the idea that was his term for the credit crunch. He never actually, I don't think, said the words credit crunch, but he actually, I think, evolved over time to realize that it was a significant issue. And so it is an instance, I think, where actually work being done at the Reserve Banks had an impact on broader monetary policy as people started to realize this wasn't just a localized problem, it wasn't just a small problem, it was actually a problem that we had to think about, the interaction between bank regulation, monetary policy, and what's happening in the real economy. So it's much less controversial now. And what's interesting, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about this in another couple slides, was that basically the work that was done on the credit crunch in the early 1990s was basically taken as given as we got into 2007 and 2008. This panel, so Jeremy was at the board, Chairman Bernanke actually was in this literature as well. So a number of people that are currently policymakers or were recently policymakers were people that were very actively engaged in this literature. So it is interesting that as we got into the financial crisis, a number of the actions taken, I think, reflected what we learned from the 1990s, and I would say also what we learned from some of the Japanese banking problems, where they didn't take the lessons that we had learned from the 1990s. So the TARP program was designed to quickly recapitalize the banks. The initial stress tests were designed so that banks wouldn't actually shrink, that they would actually have to meet the stress test by raising additional capital. The lending facilities were designed to mitigate some of the problems that were caused by non-banks not having the same degree of credit availability. So I think some of the lessons that came out of the 1990s actually were very useful as we were thinking about the problems in 2007 and 2008. So the 1990s was really a bank credit crunch, and one of the themes, and Joe's really going to talk a little bit more about this, is 2008 was much more of a financial crisis, where what we were addressing in the 1990s was much more of a banking crisis. So I'm going to show you a slide on some of what happened with the lending. The bank lending during the most recent crisis actually fell quite dramatically, but it came back very rapidly, in part because we recapitalized the bank so quickly. A lesson that we learned, but Japan didn't learn, and arguably Europe didn't learn either. And that resulted in a much slower recovery for economies that didn't take that lesson to heart. The non-depository financial intermediaries played a much larger role in 2008 than they did in the 1990s. One of the interesting aspects is part of this literature was really focused on market-centric versus bank-centric. And so one of the issues was to what extent other financial intermediaries would pick up the financing for banks. And in particular, it was thought as we move towards away from a bank-centric towards a more market-centric economy, we wouldn't really have to worry about the financial crises in the same way that we did in the 1990s. That actually turned out not to be correct, and we're going to talk a little bit about it was less of a capital crunch during 2008, much more of a liquidity problem, so that we didn't spend as much time thinking about shadow banking and runs as we probably should have going into the crisis. And the interconnectedness between the banks and the non-bank sector, I think, was only imperfectly understood. The earlier literature on the crisis really highlighted that understanding the role of financial intermediaries was very important. The institutional knowledge that is required in these kind of situations is really important. The earlier literature focused on banks. What it didn't focus on, and we're going to talk more about it in this presentation, is the broker-dealers, the money market funds, and the issuers of asset-backed securities. Those three types of institutions played a very significant role this time. They didn't in the early 1990s. But one of the interesting aspects is over the 20 years, I think many of the graduate programs became less focused on some of the regulatory and institutional details of financial markets. And as a result, we haven't had as many graduate students. I think a disproportionate number of the people that understand the inner workings of the economy are in the central bank or in other government organizations. And I think hopefully as a result of the financial crisis, the pendulum will swing back. We'll have a little bit more focus on some of these institutional details that I think were critically important. This just shows you a chart of total loans outstanding at commercial banks. The 1990s, when a lot of the literature was being written, you can see there was a reasonable decline, and you can see, again, there was a fairly substantial decline during the financial crisis. One of the interesting aspects of the 1990s was it occurred in a real estate cycle that was actually quite different. So if you look at New England, which is that dark blue line, you can see that real estate prices had gone way up in the mid-1980s. They came down quite dramatically in the late 1980s and were much more negative than other parts of the country. But while New England and the mid-Atlantic states were experiencing a lot of real estate problems, the rest of the country was not. So it really was more of a localized problem, nothing like the financial crisis where you can see all regions of the country experience declines at exactly the same time. So the real estate cycle was different, but nonetheless it was significant enough that if you look at, this is C&I lending at commercial banks, so even though it was disproportionately New England, Mid-Atlantic, and the West Coast, you can see there was a pretty dramatic decline in C&I lending that occurred during the time that we were all working on this literature. You can also see that the slope of the line in terms of the recovery was pretty gradual. If you look at the financial crisis, what's pretty striking is first how quickly bank lending fell, but also how quickly bank lending came back. So I think that is in part because of the actions taken by the federal government and by the Federal Reserve to make sure that we didn't have the kind of banking problems that we did in the early 1990s. So I would argue we would have had a much more severe outcome if we had not been so aggressive at addressing this issue. This shows you the assets of security brokers, dealers, and money market funds, as well as ABS issuers, relative to the assets of U.S. chartered depository institutions. If you look to the period around 1990, what's striking is what a small role they played in the economy at the time that this literature was being written. So we were bank-focused. People realized that there were substitutes for banks, but when it's only 20% of the assets of banks, it didn't seem nearly as important. Everybody recognized, I think, that it was a possibility. But it's, what's striking is how much that increased over the subsequent 20 years. You can see by the time we got right before the financial crisis, the assets of these non-depository financial intermediaries were the same size as the assets of the depository intermediaries, and you can also see how dramatically it decreased. So unlike that chart that showed you how quickly bank lending came back, what this shows you is not only did these other types of financial institutions dramatically increase, but they've decreased relative to the size of commercial banks, and they've continued to decrease. There has not been a bounce back. That's a very different characteristic than what we saw in the banking sector. That's very different than what I think many people in the literature expected. Many people in the literature expected that these other types of intermediaries would be much less susceptible to the problems that occurred in the banking sector. And we're going to talk a little bit more about why that turned out not to be true. So the lessons from the earlier research. TARP was not particularly popular in a public policy context, but I actually think that it was critically important for the U.S. banking system to recapitalize very quickly. We had TARP. Europe has not had TARP. As a result, it's taken them much longer to get their banks into a position that they could start lending. So that very dramatic increase in lending that we've seen on the rebound is something that we've not seen in other countries, like in Europe, like in Japan. The initial stress tests were designed in particular to avoid credit crunch kind of situations. In order to meet the stress tests, you had to be able to show that you could, that you were going to meet the capital requirements without shrinking your institution. This forced them to retain earnings. It also forced many of the institutions to raise new equity. If we had not designed it that way, there might have been an incentive to shrink. The incentive to shrink might have helped stockholders, but it clearly would have hurt those that were counting on banks for financing. So it was designed in a way that really took into account some of the lessons from the early 1990s. The liquidity programs focused on the non-banking sector and the need to get credit availability. Again, I think those programs were quite effective. The non-bank assets were small in 1990, but that really changed dramatically in 2008, and Joe's going to go through a discussion of exactly how they have changed and why that's important. Going to talk from there?
So non-banks, as they're indicated, non-banks have been less resilient in the crisis. In part, this is because banks and the non-banks and the non-depository institutions have been quite different. They were affected in quite different ways. So the capital constraints were important for banks. But they also had deposit insurance. And so, in fact, you know, when you have a crisis, quite often what you see is an inflow of deposits and a flight to safety rather than an outflow. And in addition, they had liquidity access to the discount window. Non-banks, on the other hand, had a liquidity crisis. So instead of having perhaps inflows, as banks did due to flight to safety, they had outflows, and they were very severe outflows. And so that caused them to have to shrink. It caused them to have to get rid of assets, often at high sale prices. So we have had a reexamination of regulation of banks, for example, the Dodd-Frank legislation, but we haven't had a similar reexamination of the regulation of non-banks, of these non-depository institutions. And so we need to consider the stability of these non-depository, non-bank financial intermediaries, and in terms of, you know, what happened, why did it happen, and what can we do to make it not happen next time. And in fact, as Eric indicated, the non-banks proved much slower to recover. If you remember the C&I figure from earlier, we saw a relatively rapid recovery in bank lending, you know, C&I lending, and in part that was because of the programs that were put in place to give them liquidity, to give them protection. We're going to talk about three different types of non-depository institutions: broker-dealers, money market funds, and issuers of asset-backed securities. So with broker-dealers, we all know about Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers. They were important drivers along with other broker-dealers. In particular, Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers got a lot of attention during the crisis as they essentially failed. They were very reliant on wholesale funding, so short-term wholesale funding that could run. And it had been assumed that because, for example, using repurchase agreements, These are collateralized loans. They're fairly safe. What could happen? How could that go bad? You've got collateral. But in fact, it did run. They had no insured deposits, and they didn't have the access that the banks had to the discount window for liquidity. So once investors lose confidence, which they did, you start seeing a run, and they come under tremendous pressure. So all large broker-dealers are now in bank holding companies. As you recall, Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley converted the bank holding companies, the other large domestic, you know, Merrill Lynch, was acquired. Bear Stearns technically was acquired. So all the big domestic broker-dealers, you know, went into bank holding companies or converted to bank holding companies. But that didn't solve the problems, even though bank holding companies are regulated in a way different from the broker-dealers when they were on their own in investment banks. So if you look at the assets of these security brokers and dealers, you can see, one, they were growing. They were growing even more rapidly just prior to the crisis, and then they basically plummeted. And that was in large part because of the way they'd been financed. In large, to a certain degree, they were basically doing a spread lending. We think of banks as doing spread lending, but in a sense, it was a spread lending phenomenon going on with the broker dealer. They were able to fund very cheaply using repos to fund their securities holdings. And so the cheap funding allowed them to grow their assets so rapidly that over time, as they moved into non-government issued securities and non-government guaranteed securities, for their repos, they were able to get an even larger spread. So they had an incentive to repo longer maturity for the interest rate risk, and riskier securities that had more credit risk, so they had higher interest rates and increased the spread that they were able to earn. Until it wasn't. The regulatory response is incomplete for broker-dealers. There's been no change in the broker-dealer regulations since the crisis, despite the widespread problems. They are in bank holding, at least the domestic broker-dealers are now in bank holding companies. We do have the wholesale funding capital charge, and that will help, but they still don't have the direct access to the discount window, which is available only for depository institutions. The Dodd-Frank limits the support that these non-depository subsidiaries of the bank holding companies can have, as does the Federal Reserve Act, and we have limited transparency. The SEC focus reports report a little bit, but not much. We don't really know the nature of the securities they're using for the repos that they do, for example. So we don't know exactly what collateral is being used. We don't know just how risky it is, at least in the public record. Next, money market funds. There's been a lot of attention for money market funds there recently, but not prior to the crisis. Many assumed they would be stable during the financial crisis and the financial problems because of the SEC limitations, the 2A7 rules, which limit the maturity. They can only have short maturity, so you don't have interest rate risk, and limits on credit risk. You know, they had to be A1, P1, at least as the credit rating agencies saw it. And so we had limited interest rate risk, limited credit risk. You know, so it seemed like maybe it should be fair to say. The investors often use money market funds as transaction accounts. Didn't really perceive much difference between a bank account and a money market fund. And the money market funds, unlike banks, held no capital. So you can see what happened here. The money market funds, the upper line is total, the lower line are the prime money market funds. And you can see what happened. We had rapid growth. And then when we had the Lehman failure and the reserve fund broke the bust, then you can see in the lower line, you see just this sharp drop in the prime funds, their assets under management. Although, remember, there was the Treasury insured the money market funds. And so that started coming back. It is interesting that you get this initial bump up in total money market funds, but that's the shift, the flight to safety moving to the government money market funds rather than the prime money market funds. The regulatory response, there has been some of money market funds, but it's been incomplete. The SEC has adopted rules to improve liquidity in 2010 and to require institutional, not all, but institutional prime money market funds that have a floating net asset value in 2014. We still have financial stability concerns with money market funds. The floating NAV does not apply to the retail prime money market funds. And it allows the funds with liquidity problems to impose gates and fees. Now, a concern here is that that might accelerate the run away from these funds, because once someone imposes a gate and fee, you may want to get out of your own money market fund before you're restricted with your own money market fund imposing gates and fees. The third category of the non-depository institutions we're going to talk about are asset-backed securities issuers. They've received little academic attention, again, much like the other two. Banks and finance companies removed assets from their balance sheets. They put them into special purpose vehicles so that they, you know, could avoid capital and so forth. They still could collect fees, but they had less capital risk because they pushed it off to these SPVs. There's major growth since the early 1990s. So again, we weren't really thinking about it much back then. And the structure of short-term financing for risky assets was subject to runs, as you would expect. So risk retention, the legal risk from the Dodd-Frank Act, greater reporting requirements tied to SEC regulations have all restricted their use. So what's happened is that they've fallen off. You can see the assets, just again, were growing and growing particularly rapidly right before the crisis. Then they plummeted and they haven't recovered. So they keep shrinking, and in part that's because of the uncertainty as to just what things are going to look like for them. There were Fed lending facilities that provided liquidity to these non-depositories. The use of 13.3 exemption for discount window necessary for significant lending. I have to think about that one. I think there's a word of issue. And then to help with liquidity problems of broker-dealers, we had the primary dealer credit facility and the term securities lending facility were established. We're going to show a couple of graphs in a moment. And without intervention, the market making and the critical markets may have been impaired if broker-dealers could not finance themselves and were relying on those facilities. So the earlier figures showed how the assets of the broker-dealers fell sharply, and so that meant they had less securities available for making a market. So here's the primary dealer credit facility loans outstanding. You can see the first little bit there tied to Bear Stearns, and then it eases off, and then when Lehman fails, you can see it spikes again. And it was high there, even though at that time we were moving the broker-dealers into bank holding companies. So this showed that, in fact, being a bank holding company wasn't enough to eliminate the risk that they faced. The other program, the Term Securities Lending Facility, again, you can see that this is a program where they could take their risky securities and swap them for treasury securities that were more liquid and didn't have the credit risk. And what's interesting here is this is used a lot, and it was used a lot by foreign broker-dealers. And so, remember, the domestic broker-dealers were, you know, going into bank holding companies. That wasn't enough. They still ended up borrowing. But there's a lot of presence of the foreign broker-dealers here who were very big, but also borrowed very intensively from this program. So the emergency support is restricted going forward. Financing securities of broker-dealers became a critical problem during the crisis. The Dodd-Frank restrictions or restricts lending and discourages the use of exemptions such as the 23A and 23B that allowed bank holding companies to finance non-bank subsidiaries in the crisis. Without access to liquidity and given the run risk in the crisis, we need to rethink broker-dealer regulations. banks, because that's where the problems were. These non-bank or non-depository institutions really weren't that large, and so they weren't really something that we focused on. We highlighted the need to focus on credit availability, and we emphasized the need for bank recapitalization. And as Eric noted, that hasn't been followed in Japan, and they're lost decades extended to a couple of decades, and in Europe is recovering much more slowly because they haven't recapitalized as quickly in the same way that we did. The growth of shadow banks has not received sufficient attention even now. Non-depository problems were quite different. Again, it was on the liability side, worried about runs of financing rather than losses of capital due to loan losses. But even though the non-depository problems were quite different, they were still very important, especially during the financial crisis. And the regulatory response remains incomplete today. There's much more that can be done and needs to be done. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joe.